This is a summary video for AP Physics on the concepts and the math of momentum and center of mass. So I've got the base equations there at the top. Conceptually, momentum. Measure the quantity of motion of an object. So then the more motion, i.e. the faster the object is traveling, the more momentum it will have. So momentum depends both on the mass and on the velocity. Another way of thinking of momentum is how hard is it to stop an object? Well, the more mass it has, the harder it's going to be to stop. The more velocity it has, the harder it's going to be to stop. And that's where momentum and inertia are different. Momentum is a property, resistance to change in motion, and it depends solely on inertia, on mass. So no matter how slow or fast an object is moving, it has exactly the same inertia because inertia depends only on mass. An object can never have zero inertia unless it had zero mass, but then you don't have an object. An object can have zero momentum if it has zero velocity. So momentum changes with motion. Now we can deal with momentum being conserved or being changed. If it is conserved, PI equals PF, the condition, only internal forces are acting on the objects. Remember the situation we have pondered for the last 2 years. Your car is dead in the middle of the intersection and you want to change the momentum. You cannot push internally. You cannot sit there in the car and push on the dashboard and expect your dead car to move anywhere. You have to get outside, external force. So then when there are no external forces or the net external force is zero, your momentum will stay exactly the same. That is typically useful in situations of collisions and in situations of things exploding. With collisions, we talked about inelastic collisions, the objects stick together, and elastic collisions, the objects bounce apart. In both of these situations, PI equals PF because it's two objects pushing on each other or two objects interacting in a situation where Newton's third law would apply. Now, we also talked about perfectly elastic collisions. In perfectly elastic collisions, both momentum and kinetic energy are conserved. So momentum, your MV totals stay constant. Kinetic energy, your 1/2 MV squared totals stay constant. Realistically, the only time you see perfectly elastic collisions is between atomic particles because they don't dissipate any heat and they don't make sound. And in AP problems where they say it is a perfectly elastic collision. Center of mass. That's the average position of all the particles of mass of an object or a system. And so the equations we have up here for center of mass, basically, you're just averaging the position. You're taking each particle, each MI, and you're multiplying it by the position of that particle, the XI or the YI. So you're weighting where that mass is, you're summing up all the masses and the positions, and then you're dividing by the total mass to remove that value. So then it is just the weighted positions. That is the center of mass. You can do in vectors with R's, okay? What it is useful for is allowing you to deal with a system of objects, which otherwise might be complex if you have a number of different objects moving. You can simplify it and deal with it all as a single particle at the center of mass, in which case you can then use these equations along with your center of mass and analyze the velocity of the center of mass and the acceleration of the center of mass. A situation like a firework exploding, lots of particles going everywhere, but the center of mass before the explosion and after the explosion has exactly the same path, maybe a projectile motion path. So even though pieces go in many directions, that center of mass had no external forces changing its motion, and so it will maintain that projectile path. Well, no external forces besides gravity, but it will maintain that projectile path. Now, here are some various different diagrams for almost the last 10 years of problems that have come up on the AP Physics C exam, and I marked them by year. These are all from the C exam, and I marked which problem. You can Google them if you want to find out more specifics, but kind of going down the screen. 2006, Mechanics 2. You had the two blocks there, M, the 2M and the 3M. 2M was sitting there, 3M was moving in with an initial velocity of V0. It hit 2M, and so in the course of the problem, you analyze the collision, the compression of the spring, I believe that was a nonlinear spring, and other things. But during the instant of the collision, so as your 3M is moving across, the instant before it strikes the 2M to the instant after it strikes the 2M, PI is equal to PF. So then you can do the sum of the MVs before and the sum of the MVs afterwards, and your totals before and after are equal to each other. It is only the instant, okay? And so then the fact that there is a spring there on the other side of the 2M doesn't make a difference. That spring will come into play in the subsequent motions. 2015, Mechanics 2, you had a projectile being fired at 10 meters per second at an angle of 30 degrees. And this problem scenario has shown up a few times on AP exams, whereby that projectile hits a block that's hanging from a string, and it either embeds in the block or it goes through the block. But for the instant of the collision, before the projectile hits and the instant after it hits, that momentum is conserved, and so then the block had no velocity before, but it will have velocity afterwards, and it will swing up, and then you could use conservation of energy to analyze the swing and maybe circular motion things also. 2014, Mechanics Problem 3. There was a person standing on a circular disc of a certain radius, and they throw an object. Well, I believe that surface was a frictionless surface. Before they threw the object, the person, the object, and the circular disc they were standing on were not moving. So the initial momentum was final, or was zero. So if I go PI equals PF, if nothing was moving beforehand, that initial momentum is equal to zero. Well, that means the total of all your momentum afterwards was zero also. And so then the MV for the disc and the person and the MV for the projectile that was thrown at V0, that total would be equal to zero. And that situation was analyzed. I believe maybe that person then later in the problem turned and threw a tangent, and that got into conservation of angular momentum. 2018, Mechanics 2, collision of cart 1 and cart 2. Now, there is a spring between them, but that spring is still going to be a short, impulsive force. And so momentum will still be conserved for the interval while it is compressing and stretching back out. PI equals PF. 2011, Mechanics 1, launching device fired a projectile. That projectile then went into motion, and one smaller part of the problem dealt with that projectile hitting a wooden block. And at first that wooden block was clamped down and it couldn't move, and then the clamp was removed. And so when the clamp was removed, PI equals PF. The projectile, I believe, embedded in the wood block. And so then inelastic collision, and they move together with the same final velocity. So kind of recognize different situations where momentum is conserved. I want to go back here for a second. Don't want to pass over right there. When you have an external force applied, or impulse, then momentum is changed. Your easiest way to be able to determine whether you're dealing with momentum being conserved or not is if you're dealing with a change in momentum, that's an impulse, that's an F delta T equals M delta V, you are typically dealing with one object. So if you're dealing with a single object, I was going to move that over there. That's not going to happen. If you're dealing with one object, it may not be for the whole problem, but for a particular question, one object, and the force being applied to that one object, if it's only a single object, it has to be an external force, which then means you're going to use momentum or impulse, F delta T equals M delta V. If you're dealing with conservation of momentum, you have to be dealing with at least two different objects. You're dealing with either an objects colliding with each other, an object exploding into multiple different pieces, but you have more than one thing and you have an interaction because Newton's third law applies. So then you have momentum being conserved. Now I want to take a minute to talk about systems of objects. Here we have different systems of objects. So if we deal with the first situation, I have a person standing on a board. Let's say that they are initially at rest. Well, if they're initially at rest, then the center of mass of the system would probably be somewhere in that location, a little bit closer to the person. If it starts at rest, then anything that happens internally between the person and the board, that center of mass is not going to move. So then if your person walks over this way and the center of mass is going to stay there, the board is going to have to shift the other way. Our person's kind of balancing there so that the center of mass stays at rest. And I didn't move them quite proportionately, but the center of mass should stay in exactly the same location. By the same idea, our two situations to the right there, if this center of mass starts at rest and the person throws the ball, having a rough time here. If the person throws the ball, well, the ball goes flying. And if the ball goes flying, it left its outer shell behind. There we go. It went flying and it has a certain momentum. That means our person and our chair must recoil with a certain backwards velocity, so that the initial momentum was zero, the total final momentum must also be zero. So even though each of these moved off with different velocities, your total momentum would still be zero. Same case here with a bullet being fired. If the bullet is fired with a certain velocity, the gun will recoil. Oh, I thought this diagram was going to work for me. There, it will recoil, and so you'll end up with a velocity here and a velocity there, velocity of the bullet, velocity of the gun, but PI is equal to PF, zero initial if it started at rest, zero final. Bullet will have a positive momentum, gun will have a negative momentum, opposite vector directions. Down below, we have our two cars. And when they crash, I'm going to say that your green car has a larger momentum than your black car. So when they crash into each other, the total momentum still stays the same. So then after the crash, if the green car had more momentum, they're going to move off in this direction still with the same total momentum. So then this would be, I'm not even going to try colors. MV for the black and MV for the green combined at your final velocity. So thinking about larger systems of objects, the momentum will stay constant as long as you are internal. Now, especially down here for our two cars colliding, you have to remember it is the instant before the interaction is equal to the instant after the interaction. That's when the momentum is conserved. Now, coming back here for a minute, conservation of momentum, I would assume you're probably going to see it in one form or fashion. Oftentimes in the past, it has been in situations where other parts of the problem, you would also use conservation of mechanical energy. In the past, center of mass has shown up really only significantly in the multiple choice. Obviously, there is no multiple choice this year, okay? So it's not going to show up in the multiple choice. It may show up in the problems as a part, as a single question. In terms of a derivation, based on past experience, I would be surprised if there was a derivation, especially since the problem solving is limited and it's more explanations this year. So you may have to explain through something that you would do in terms of finding a center of mass, but it's unlikely you're going to see a calculus derivation based on the format of the exam. That is a pretty good overall summary of momentum and center of mass. Ponder physics.